Voilà, our repo will be shared. Unfortunately, we have to speak in English. My Slovenian has not not really improved sufficiently to speak in Slovenian. Tonight, we will visit the state socialist experiences in Czechoslovakia, the GDR, and in Poland. And thus, attempts of building socialism in rather economically advanced countries. And I think that the Czechoslovak experience is possibly particularly interesting for several reasons. Like in Yugoslavia, there was a very strong national liberation movement, at least in Slovakia. There was the Slovenské národné povstanie in 1944, in central Slovakia, which temporarily liberated part of the then fascist vassal state of Slovakia. And so far, the Communist Party, at least in Slovakia, had a special type of legitimacy because of that struggle. And I think that if one discusses democratic socialism, I would say that the Prague and Bratislava experience, the Prague and Bratislava Spring of 1968, is still very important. It was a very important experience. So in the end, it was brought to an end by external intervention. And I would say even the Polish experience and the Polish worker rebellions, the Solidarność movement of 1980-1981 is rather interesting in several respects in regard to the question of socialism. Of course, self-management, Samo Povajenje, was a catchword of Solidarność, of the early Solidarność as well, but it's very often forgotten. And today, Solidarność is very different from that experience. But nevertheless, it is part of the Polish history as well. And my idea is to start with how that state socialist experiences in the region were started in the mid-1940s, how the basic traits of state socialism were established in the late 1940s, 1950s, and then I would say some more conceptual remarks and define basic traits, and then I would like to highlight key political, economic, and social developments in the subsequent decades. And actually, there are certain parallels between the GDR, Czechoslovakia, and Poland during the following four decades. I will start with the end of the war. Actually, the situation in the three countries was very different, and the war experience, of course, had been very different as well. Poland was one of the countries in Europe that suffered most from the Nazi fascist occupation. And in Poland, the resistance movement had been divided into several wings. And the stronger wing in the end was rather the conservative one of the Armia Krajowa. And the Polish left, especially the Communist Party, had already suffered a lot from Stalinism. As you know, the Communist Party of Poland was dissolved by the Comintern. Many of the cadres who had been in the Soviet Union were not only imprisoned, but many of them killed. Insofern, the party was de facto liquidated. And the Polish, something like a new Polish Communist Party, so with a different name, was only established later on what was left of the Communist Party, and that was obviously the weaker part of the resistance movement. And in addition, Poland had been shifted to the West. And I mean, apart from the occupation, from the enormous repression by the German Nazi fascism, that implied that people were relocated from what today is the western part of Ukraine to the western part of what is today Poland. And the state had to be totally rebuilt. And it was a very difficult situation. And though those who agree that some basic had to change in regard to the interwar era, the legitimacy of this left-wing current was not very strong. The situation in Czechoslovakia was very different. First of all, differently from Poland, the Communist Party had been very strong in the interwar years in Czechoslovakia. It had been a legal party. Actually, it was even in the 1920s and 1930s, it was even a mass party, because it was formed out of the left wing of the Social Democrat Party. And a large part of the Social Democrat Party formed de facto the Communist Party. And so far, the Social Democrat traditions were incorporated in the Communist Party. In the case of Slovakia, the Communists were stronger than the Social Democrat Party. In Slovakia, the Communist Party was an essential part of the resistance movement against the Tiso regime, a clerical fascist regime in Slovakia. And in 1944, this Slovenské Narodné Povstanie was organized both by the Communists, some Social Democrats, and I would say Liberal Democrats. And some people, key people of the state apparatus, supported this uprising. And the uprising succeeded to liberate temporarily parts of Slovakia. And the Soviet army did not come early enough in order to that uprising to survive militarily. Therefore, many of the cadres went to the mountains and joined already existing partisan groups. And the liberation of Czechoslovakia obviously started from the east. In the so-called protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia, under Nazi occupation, the Communist Party was in the resistance as well, so it was not the only resistance force. And the Communists had a lot of legitimacy after the war. In the Czech land, they were the strongest party. And in free elections, first free elections in the whole of the country, the Communist Party gained almost 40%. So far, it was really a very strong force, and jointly with other left-wing forces, it formed the majority. But it was stronger for socio-economic regions in the Czech lands rather than in Slovakia. Slovakia was still very rural at that time. And one consequence of the Slovak uprising was that in the so-called Košice program, autonomy for Slovakia was inscribed, and the more equilibrated relationship between the Czech part and the Slovak part. That's very important for the future. And how that was fulfilled or rather not fulfilled. And in the GDR, or what was not yet the GDR, it was in 1945, it was the Soviet occupation zone of occupied Germany. The conditions, I mean, were even different because, I mean, the state structures were directly rebuilt under, in that case, after the starting of the Cold War, under Soviet supervision. Nevertheless, the Communist Party had been an important political force, though with a lot of problems as well, in interwar Germany. And it had been a key force of resistance against Nazi fascism. So far, the party had a legitimacy. The same applies basically for the Social Democrats as well, though the Social Democrats were less successful for a couple of reasons in the resistance, but the Social Democracy had been part of the resistance movement as well. There had been calls for the unity of the two parties, but the way that unity was created from above in what was to become the GDR proved to be rather problematic. And in all three countries, it was the idea at the beginning that the Soviet experience would not be simply replicated, but that there would the idea of therefore people's democracies was to build something like a national form of socialism, though with a strong socialized sector, land reform, nationalization of the banks and key industries, but not necessarily with a total nationalization of all business, for example. No? That implied planning, but not necessarily the replication of the Soviet type of planning. For example, in Czechoslovakia, the exiles who returned from Britain, for example, were in favor of planning as well. But they had a different idea how that planning should be done in the end. And they argued, for example, that heavy industries should not necessarily be the key industrial component, that under other industrial branches should be developed as well, and it's in so far a more equilibrated development model should be built. And especially in Czechoslovakia, there was strong pressure from the workers in the factories that some radical measures should be taken in order to change society. And so far, there was a certain even social impulse for radical changes. But under conditions in which one still has to remember that these societies were deeply traumatized by the experience of war, and in the case of Czechoslovakia and Poland, of the Nazi fascist occupation. And that there was a lot of fear and people having to readapt to what was to be a more normal way of life, at least compared with the war era. The space for, I would say, autonomous changes probably was diminished as well by the escalating of the Cold War started very rapidly after 1945. And this Cold War diminished not only the space for maneuver in the West, and as you know, our communist parties were gradually expelled from the governments in Western Europe, and for example, the agenda for transformation in the western part of Germany was diminished as well. If you read the early constitutions of the German Länder of 1946, for example, in the constitution of the region of Hessen, you can still read that banks should be socialized, basic industries should be socialized, and that the cooperative movement should be promoted by the state. So that was the mood of the times. And in the GDR, Poland, and in Czechoslovakia, the implication was that the direct Soviet influence became stronger and stronger. And that the Soviet Union, which was under Stalinist leadership at that time, pushed for taking full control of the state. And even in Czechoslovakia, where the Communist Party could have governed with multi-party elections even in the future because they had such a strong mandate, they made something like a self-coup. It was a so-called Vitasi figure. And with that, I would say, in all three countries, something like a Stalinization of society and of the state began. And the monopoly, de facto, power monopoly of the governing party was established. And the spaces for debate, both inside the party and outside the party, were drastically reduced. And that, I would say, something like the unquestioned loyalty of the momentarily ruling line of the party was established. And so-called left-wing, right-wing opportunists, so-called bourgeois nationalists, members of the party, were prosecuted. And that, in so far, a very authoritarian type of governing was established. And in most cases, it was cadres who had been in the Soviet Union in the past in exile, was those who got the key posts in the new governments. And among those who were prosecuted within the party, it was especially people who had fought in Spain on the side of the Republicans, who had been in the West in exile. In the worst phase, I must admit, or we must see as well, Jews, especially in Czechoslovakia. There was even an anti-Semit tendency, and that was imported in a way from the Soviet Union. And with this, I would say, the rule of the game became in a very an opportunist following the party leadership. And some of the party leaders, like Gottwald himself, Gottwald remembered very well that he had defended the Czechoslovak way to socialism. But after 1948, that was out of question for the Soviet Union. And he knew, that the Soviet leadership knew, that he had been in favor of the Czechoslovak way to socialism. So far, he was a super loyal party leader. And in the case of Czechoslovakia, the leadership of the Slovak National Uprising was imprisoned, all of them, both of the Communist Party and outside the Communist Party. For example, Gustav Husák, later party leader of the normalization period, he was imprisoned as well, for example. No? Was severely tortured, but he did not confess to something he had not done. With that, the process against him was derailed. He survived Stalin, and with that he survived. He was not hanged like Clementis before. And these, I would say, have been traumatic, in a way traumatic experiences for the society. And I would say very deforming ones as well. And in Czechoslovakia, among the three countries, this Stalinist repression was the strongest. In Poland, Inclanski was, for example, he was hanged. Gomulka, in Poland, he was only imprisoned. And in the GDR, because of the direct competition with the Federal Republic of Germany, such processes were out of question. So there was this repression as well, did not go as far as, for example, in Czechoslovakia. And I would say with that political structure, a certain, that had an influence on the social structure as well. One could argue that the main economic and political parameters were defined by the leadership of the party and the state. And we can say that the state had a double character. There was a party which was a state party, and then there was a state apparatus, and the two were interlinked. The strategic decisions were taken by the party leadership, especially by the Politburo and the central committee. But they were implemented by the ministry and by the formal structure, by the former structure of the state. Since property was nationalized or mainly transformed into state ownership, and in the case of the three countries it was called state ownership, not social property like in Yugoslavia, and I would say that makes a certain difference. And the small cooperative sector existed as well, mainly in agriculture. One could argue that the top layers of the state, that is the party leadership plus central bureaucracy of the state plus top management of the state-owned companies, were those who decided how a surplus was produced and how it was to be used. I would say with that you have something like the crystallization, I would say, of a class. Not of a bourgeois class, obviously, because it is not private property, nor is or was the surplus appropriated privately. The disposal over the surplus, it was politically mediated in a way, it was collective, but nevertheless, it was a circumscribed group which had a decisive influence how this surplus was to be used. And of course, they decided in the end as well how the workforce was to be deployed. And I would say that is a second definition or second question of class. It's not only the appropriation of and use decision about the use of social surplus, but as well whether somebody is able to control his or her own labor force or not, or is able to control the labor force of others. I would argue that this group could decide how the workforce was deployed. From my point of view, you can use a Marxist definition of class and come to the conclusion that something like class came into existence, no? In these countries as well, and I would argue in the Soviet Union as well. At times it is argued that it was only a social stratum. Maybe we can discuss about that later. But this implies as well, I mean, that there was something like a social tension and social conflict between the direct producers and those who decided how production was to be organized. And actually, this type of tensions and conflicts did arise. And if you read interviews on these times, and especially around Solidarność in the early 1980s contemporary literature, it is them and us as the party leadership, and them as the workers. We are the workers. Yeah? So far, this cleavage was perceived as well. But it was not permitted that social forces can organize into their own autonomous organizations. So there were trade unions, they were not autonomous trade unions, but something like transmission belts of the party, which at times, in certain regards, negotiated with the company management on social issues of the company, social welfare, maybe the special, what is it called in English? Prämie. Special rewards, things like that. And one has to see that especially in the GDR and in Czechoslovakia, in the factories, because of the long industrial tradition, there were still workers with a lot of trade union experience. And they found ways, even within these conditions, to raise certain demands. In Poland it was less of them because, I mean, it had been much more rural country and industrialization only started in earnest after 1945 in many parts of the country, not the whole country. In Slovakia a bit similar. And insofar, and there were channels of redress, they were usually individual channels. You could make a petition, Eingabe. But I mean, that is not a way to deal with, I would say, more systemic problems. And I would say that was and has continued or continue to be a central problem, that contradictions, tensions, could not be openly articulated. And that means that they could not openly resolve as well. I think that was a very serious limitation, though particularly pressing in the late 1940s and early 1950s. Workers had more rights at the factory level. They could not be fired, for example. Huh? Or not easily be fired because it was not so easy to replace them, for example. Huh? And social security was strongly expanded. The wage structure was much more egalitarian than before. And there was a strong egalitarian ethos in the workforce. There can be no doubt about that. And actually, when the party leadership tried in the countries from time to differentiate which is more workers, in a way, try to resist that. So far, this, I would say, this egalitarian values actually became ingrained in the workforce. And it was especially physical labor that was rather well rewarded. And intellectual labor or care work were not so much or not so well rewarded. And in a way, one can see though, and that is a gender issue, women became incorporated into wage labor. So far, women got an own source of income and thus became more independent from their husbands. Women wages tended to be lower than male wages, because it was male physical labor which was particularly well rewarded. In addition, one can see that though social infrastructure like crèches were expanded, and I mean that helped women, the division of labor inside the household was not discussed. It usually remained as it had been before. So that was a limitation of women's emancipation, I would say an important one. And if you have a look at the Politburo level or the Central Committee, I mean, women were almost totally absent. So far, in the key posts of power, you could hardly find women. And I would say that was a very serious limitation as well. And as you did not have an autonomous trade unions, for example, you did not have, of course, autonomous women organizations. You had women organizations, but I would say it is a specific task. And the economic and social development was strongly politically influenced and conscious, I would say consciously influenced, but not, and that is a limitation, but obviously not democratically. Because decision making was neither transparent nor with an open, usually not with an open debate, and decisions were top down. Though, I mean, if it is said that it was a so-called command economy, that is really stupid nonsense. Because, I mean, the planning was a negotiation process between the planning organization and the factory directors. Yeah? With different interests, planning, high targets, directors are more modest, and the workforce, of course, in that regard, more modest as well. In order to be able to fulfill the plan, not only 100%, but more than that. Otherwise, no rewards. And so far, and that was obviously a negotiation process. But it was a negotiation process with a bias. And the bias was towards heavy industry. And this is a replication of the Soviet experience. And I would say that in the beginning, many local economists, technicians were not too happy about that. And heavy industry was disproportionately expanded in all three countries, without exception. And with that, the interest groups, I would say, the informal interest groups of heavy industry became a predominant one, more important than the others. And the resources, technical resources, material resources, were particularly channeled to heavy industry, to the detriment of light industry, consumer good industries, but as well, to a certain extent, social services. And one can see recurrent development cycle that heavy industry expanded too rapidly, that more capacity was built up than could be utilized in the end, so that a disproportion between section one and section two in Marxist terms, that is between capital goods industry and consumer goods industry, developed in favor of the former. And the relative neglect of consumer goods industries implied scarcity of consumer goods as a recurrent phenomenon. And this recurrent phenomenon produced obviously discontent of workers, because though they had their wages, they could not spend them as they would have liked to. And then at times, in order to deal with the with these disproportions, prices were increased, especially in Poland. And the prices were increased, or the norms were increased, so that the real wages would decline. Tensions developed, at times openly, GDR 1953, Czechoslovakia 1953, Poland 56, 1970, 1976, 1981. So in Poland you really had a cycle of workers' revolts. And so far a certain way of crisis, a certain type of crisis did exist in the state socialist economies as well. So a different one from capitalist economies. Second phenomenon linked to this economic system was that in the more complex the economic system was, and the more developed the technological basis already was, the less able the economy was to grow, and the less dynamic it was. Therefore, Czechoslovakia had a slow-growing economy, and the GDI economy was doing relatively well, but not as well as the Polish or Romanian or Yugoslav economy. Because this type of economy was able to produce extensive growth by pursuing the existing technological paradigm, using more workers, more machines, etc. But not so good about increasing labor productivity, for example. And in the GDR and in Czechoslovakia, the first signs of limitation, of exhaustion, of this extensive growth already became visible in the late 1950s and early 1960s. Therefore, the first discussions about economic reform already evolved in the early 1960s and developed during the 1960s. In the case of the GDR, these discussions remained confined to the economic sphere. And the main idea was to increase the autonomy of the firms, of the state-owned firms, and to have success criteria which would be more dependent on the surplus that would be created, and not so much on reaching a certain predefined level of plan fulfillment. The thinking in Czechoslovakia was similar, actually, in the Soviet Union of that time as well. And in the case of Czechoslovakia, the discussion went much further, and party intellectuals like Otto Schick argued in favor of more market elements and self-management of the firms, and I mean that had some affinity with Yugoslavia. And if one reads Czechoslovak philosophical social science texts of that time, you will find many references, really many references to the Yugoslav debates of that of those times, including references to the Praxis Group, Marxist left of that times. And in Czechoslovakia, discussion began as well on question of democratization of decision making in a way. So far, the political sphere became increasingly involved as well. And the main motor of change was the intellectuals within the party. So far, it was a reform movement, mainly, though not exclusively, inside the party. But the initiative at the beginning was clearly inside the party, and it gained strong support among writers, filmmakers, etc. Cultural journals like Kulturni Život were important arenas of discussion. And in Czechoslovakia, this debate had a second component as well, and that was the so-called Slovak question, the question of the status of Slovakia inside the GSSR. And the Slovak intellectuals demanded more autonomy. And it was actually a party leader who came from Slovakia, Alexander Dubček, I mean, who was in the end elected as a new party leader and in a way personified these changes. Inside the party, you had different currents, some calling for radical democratization, others close to the Soviet leadership resisting, but the latter were in the clearly in the minority. And in 1968, censorship was abolished in Czechoslovakia, for example. Discussions became much more open. Democratization at the factory level was started. What was not really discussed was the democratization of economic policy decision making at the national level. I would say that is a key question that was not resolved in Yugoslavia as well. And I would say that was a key limitation of all experiences. What evolved in Czechoslovakia was increasingly unacceptable to the Soviet leadership. And in the end, as you know, in 1968, Soviet Union jointly with the neighboring states, intervened militarily in Czechoslovakia. And the reformist leadership was in the beginning still strong enough to prevent the total demise of the experience. There was a strong social struggle at all levels for more than a year about the further course. And that was in the end defeated, and I would say that was really a crushing and humiliating defeat. And that was not a question of a few weeks, it was really more than a year. And I think that should not be forgotten, that it was such a strong social process. And social forms of resistance, and tragically enough, I already mentioned Gustav Husák, Gustav Husak became the new party leader with Soviet backing, and in the end he was the person who was to personify the end of the Czech and Bratislava Spring. And he started a normalization and a certain way, I mean it was a repression, but it was not on the line of the 1950s. Thus, you did not have arbitrary prosecution. People were not accused of things they had not done, they were accused of things they had done. That was different as Peter Ruhl, a left-wing dissident of those times, just mentioned in his memoirs. And the forms of repression were more subtle. People were fired from jobs they liked and demoted to jobs they did not like supervising the heating of houses, for example. Yeah. The children were discriminated at school. They could not go to university, at least not to the Philosophická fakulta. Yeah. At most, technical subjects. Yeah. And things like that. Hundreds of thousands of party members were purged from the party, and when they were purged from the party, that had certain consequences. Yeah. And people were made to resign to their private sphere. And the deal was a certain type of social welfare in the exchange for people to shut up. And those who remained in the party, many of them did so, I would say, mainly for reasons of convenience. Harsher words would be possible as well. In the GDR, these reforms were stopped in a very as well around 1970. It's a change from Ulbricht to Honecker. Honecker instituted the unity of economic and social policies. And the deal in a way was similar to the Czechoslovak normalizatia. Improving the social situation in exchange for people to remain relatively quiet, following the basic rules would be fine, and so far an active commitment was not demanded as in the past. But nor were the real limits to participation were very strongly, I would say, defined. They were not zero, but I would say the parameters were rather narrow. In Poland, you had Second Workers' Revolt in 1970. And it was in the beginning Gomulka, the hero of 1956, now moved against workers again as well. He was demoted and replaced by Gierek. Gierek had a different kind of discourse, closer to the people. And he had the same idea like in Czechoslovakia, in GDR, improving living standards. And Poland was in the, I would say, least advantageous position to do so because the industrial structures were the weakest. And insofar, what did the Gierek government do? They went, like in Yugoslavia, for external credits. So, I mean, how could you improve consumer good situation? By importing them. I mean, that was the fastest way to do it. How could you modernize factories, by buying machinery abroad. And in the 1970s, credits were cheap. And Poland, Hungary, Yugoslavia, Romania had access to cheap credits. And the bad thing was that, I mean, Poland imported more and more, and so exports did not grow as rapidly as imports. And when international interest rates increased in the late 1970s, due to the so-called Volcker shock, Mm. A shock. I mean, it was a shock to the Polish government as well as to the Yugoslav. And with that, the Polish crisis already started before the Mexican one. The Mexican was in 1982. The Poland things already 1980, 1981, were rather dramatic. Austerity was the order of the day. And one of the reasons why Solidarność emerged, was exactly bad economic and social situation. And in the case of Poland, dissident intellectuals and workers had forged links in the 1970s. Particularly after the strikes of 1976. And out of that experience grew the demand and the attempt to build autonomous workers' organizations. And Solidarność, in the end, was the attempt to build an autonomous trade union. It was a trade union and workers' organization with a strong egalitarian ethos. And de facto, still being rather pro-socialist at that time. Last year, Karol Modzelewski, one of the intellectual leaders of the Polish opposition, played a role in Solidarność. He remembers that at that time, Solidarność was blamed by the party to be anti-socialist, and Solidarność said, "We are not anti-socialist." And it Solidarność, or most of Solidarność, understood itself not as being anti-socialist, but only this first generation. That's very important. But it was a national movement, a popular movement as well. And so far, it had different components or elements. It was more than just a trade union. And social self-government was one of the key demands of Solidarność. So that notion, it was not yet so clear what that really in the end would imply. But from the point of view of Solidarność, it certainly implied an important role of workers in the state-owned firms, especially a role in the decision-making of the firms, including the election of the directors. And actually, in 1981, the law was partially amended according to the demands of Solidarność, but the implementation left a lot to be desired. And these changes were resisted both by parts of the party leadership, or by most of the party leadership, and of course, again, by the Soviet Union. Martial law was declared in December 1981. Solidarność was banned, and in a way was meshed. It only survived, as Modzelewski said, as an anti-communist conspiracy. That's with a very different character. I think that is very important to see. So far, this tradition, in a way, suffered a defeat as well. The economic and social crisis continued in Poland throughout the 1980s. And so far, the party was not able to rebuild its legitimacy by improving the economic and social situation, because it was not able to do so. In the case of the GDR in Czechoslovakia, the economic situation was less dramatic than in Poland. Nevertheless, the growth dynamics slowed down considerably. It proved to be very difficult to change the technological paradigm. In the GDR, for example, microelectronics was developed. A lot of funds were channeled into it. But for a small country, relatively small country like the GDR, with then 17 million inhabitants, to build such a new technology on its own, it's a bit difficult. Actually, it proved to be too difficult. And for example, the Soviet Union and the GDR developed their microelectronics sector separately without any cooperation. It was not a very brilliant idea either, but it was done for security reasons. And the GDR incurred more debt under special political conditions with the Federal Republic of Germany. And both in Czechoslovakia and the GDR and in Poland, more and more resources had to be channeled into the export sector in order to cope with the deteriorating external economic relations. So far, there was not necessarily an absolute decline, but definitely a relative decline. And in Poland, partially even an absolute decline, because at the time there was severe recession. The economic and social crisis eroded, obviously, the legitimacy of the whole system. Opposition was not very strongly organized. I would say it was still the strongest in Poland because remnants of Solidarność subsisted in the underground. The intellectual scene in Poland was larger than in the GDR or in Czechoslovakia. It had more of an institutionalized background. And its composition changed, it moved to the right, increasingly to the right after the smashing of Solidarność. And inside Solidarność, and especially among the advisors of Solidarność, neoliberal thinking, for example by economists like Balcerowicz, developed very strongly. And in Czechoslovakia, you had mainly in the Czech Republic, Charta 77, which consisted partially of liberals and partially of rather left-wing oriented former socialist reformers at the end of 1980s, this reformist socialist wing formed its own association, Obroda. In Slovakia, you had a strong, relatively strong Catholic dissent. In the GDR, you had reformist margins, intellectual margins in the SED, that is the governing party. You had independent peace movement, ecological movement, partially under the roof of the church, but many of them emigrated to the West. And in so far, I would say something like a nucleus of an organized opposition more or less only existed in Poland. And it was Poland that, the first attempt to deal politically with the crisis, with the round table, was established and the negotiated change was initiated. I think it is important to see that in none of the three countries, the then party leaderships had a clear idea of what to do. In a way, I would say even they abdicated. And Modzelewski underlined that even within the ruling party, there was already a strong neoliberal current. That joined, in a way, the neoliberal current on the other side. And the result was a shock therapy of the early 1990s. And Solidarność, in a way, abandoned its former the workers, many of the intellectuals, so not all of the intellectuals of around Solidarność abandoned the workers as well. Modzelewski, for example, said that most of his colleagues sided sided with neoliberal economists and with the new capitalist forces, and but he himself felt loyal to the workers. And so far, the left-wing current out of Solidarność was formed as well near Pratzi, but in the end it was not very successful. In Czechoslovakia, you can see, when you read interviews of the time of key cadres of the party, what they describe, that the party leadership knew that the end was coming more or less, but they did not have a clear idea what to do. They negotiated as well, and for me, it is telling that Šalfa was nominated as prime minister by the outgoing communist party. He negotiated to make Havel the president of Dubček. Yeah? And all communist MPs voted for Havel. I mean, so they made the choice as well. Yeah? And many of the second layer of the state apparatus made their career under capitalist conditions. And the dissidents did not play much of a role in Czech or Slovak policies or politics later. Very few of them. Many of those who later got top positions had resigned them rather well with normalizacja. And they coped well with the new situation as well and used their contacts. As you know, now the new finance minister of the Czech Republic, Andrej Babiš, originally from Slovakia. For example, Babiš worked for the foreign trade company of Czechoslovakia, of one of the foreign trade companies, used that position to accumulate his own property in the early 1990s, and now is the richest man in the Czech Republic and Minister of Finance. And I would say that there have been a number of careers of that time. For me, it shows that over time, this state socialist order had become shallow, and that in a way, adapting to the existing circumstances became a main criteria for political and social advancement. And I would say that this became much stronger after the defeat of the Spring, as it became much stronger in the case of Poland with the destruction of Solidarność. And insofar, I would describe the end of state socialism rather as an implosion of state socialism. And I would say that the Stalinist beginnings were never really overcome, and that these power structures and attitudes that were nurtured during the Stalinist phase had a long-term self-destructive impact on state socialism. Nevertheless, one can see that a certain inner potential did exist to transform the state socialist order into a more socialist order and a more democratic one. For me, this is the experience of the Prague and Bratislava Spring, when really the party and this renewal movement had a lot of social support. It was a real political and social movement. And in the cultural sphere, I mean, it was more than a spring, it was a full summer. Yeah? And one could see what egalitarian conditions and something like egalitarian, almost self-organization with state support could achieve. Yeah? The new wave in the Czechoslovak film, for example, as a cultural expression of that, in literature, etc. Yeah? One can see that. Yeah? I mean, it was possibly the best time of Czechoslovak culture for the last 70 years, was exactly those years. Yeah? And I would say it became clear that it is easier to define a democratization of the economy at the micro level of the firm or factory or office, and that it is very difficult to define it for the national level, for the macro level. And I would say that one of the main challenges for democratic socialism would be exactly this, the democratization of economic and social policy making at the macro level. And with that, I would like to stop the lecture and to start the discussion. Voilà.
Začnemo da kakšno vprašanje, zdaj na voljo, da dvignete roko in počakajte na mikrofon, pa vprašate v angleškem jeziku ali podate zgolj kakšen komentar.
Well, of course, commentary is as well.
Well, I have a certain, maybe rather marginal questions. The question, not dealing with the basic political economical issues, but more geographical one. You are systematically speaking about Prague and Bratislava Spring, although in the mass consciousness it is usually called the Prague Spring. So I would like to hear an argument about the Prague and Bratislava Spring. Otherwise, my comment would be that, of course, the real issue and the real challenge is what you have pointed at the end of your lecture. This is the thing that we should be considering the most. But still, I would have a small question about this. Did the Prague and Bratislava Spring had, although it was very short, did it anyway had some economic impact as well? Did things start to change in terms of how enterprises were run and in terms of the performances of the Czechoslovakian economy? Thanks.
It is important to see that though Czechoslovakia was one country, it was one country with two languages to start with. Secondly, this a history that had it in the two parts, the socio-economic structure of the two parts was still different. Czech lands and Moravia having a long industrial history, as in Slovakia, except for a few places like Bratislava, Košice. Industrialization started in earnest only in 1945. So in Slovakia, the population was still very rural, and it was the first generation of workers that came into being after 1945. The Slovak Party, KSS, Komunistická strana Slovenska, had its own role during the war. And all prominent Slovak left-wing intellectuals, almost all of them were present during Stalinism. Party leadership plus intellectuals. at the rehabilitation of these intellectuals and party leaders who had been accused of bourgeois nationalism was one of the key fights in the 1960s. And Gustav Husak was actually one of the key persons involved in that. And in Slovakia, both democratization and autonomy were important. And this autonomy question was particularly important. And some of the most important intellectual organs like Kultúrny život actually were Slovak. And so far, I would say that there was a own Slovak component as well. And it was not a coincidence that Alexander Dubček was a Slovak, not Czech. Interestingly enough, his successor, Husák, was Slovak as well. And the only thing of the reform agenda of 1968 that was completely implemented was autonomy for Slovakia in the end. And so far I would say that there was a Bratislava Spring as well, except for my affinity with Slovakia. And what is interesting as well, that Dubček still in Slovakia is popular today. And a young US historian did research on 1989-1990 in Slovakia and the protest movement in Slovakia. And he did a lot of research outside Bratislava, almost completely outside Bratislava and the towns outside Bratislava. And he detected that except for democratization and the desire for freedom, that a lot of times the question of democratic socialism was raised as well outside Bratislava, what is not very well known, hardly discussed in Slovakia today. So far, this certain heritage, I would say, it remained, it is neglected. Part incipient steps actually were implemented in Czechoslovakia of these reforms, especially autonomization of the companies. Even first steps towards more involvement of the workers were passed as well, but hardly implemented. It seems that these first steps were rather successful in so far, at least in so far as the growth temporarily accelerated. Nevertheless, I would say that the period is too short to make a real judgment on that. I would not do that. And later on, that was abandoned by the Czechoslovak government. And what Czechoslovakia was rather successful in was to make the living conditions between the Czech lands and Slovakia relatively equal. And the per capita income at the end of the GSSR was almost equal. And though the branch structure still differed and it proved to be more vulnerable in the Slovak case. But very different from the Yugoslav experience, one can say that Czechoslovakia really succeeded in bringing the richer and the poorer part of the country much closer together. You know? And I would say that really was it. I would say that was an economic achievement.
I have two other questions about the Prague and Bratislava state.
What is more?
How did the Soviet Union respond to that? I'm wondering how did the Soviet Communist Party respond to the spring? I mean, we know it with tanks, but I mean ideologically, because the way I understand it, from Dubček's point of view, he was not acting against Soviet policy, but only naturally expanding it. By this time, the Soviet Communist Party had declared there is communism in the Eastern Bloc, the revolution has run its course, there is no more class conflict. And from once you have such a point of view, the natural thing to do is let's start bettering people's lives in this classless society, which then implies democratization and a certain degree of liberalization. I'm wondering how did the Soviet Union respond to this besides with tanks? And the other question is, you started comparing the spring with Yugoslavia. My impression is that this is a failed Yugoslavian split with Moscow. And that Dubček and his policy failed in this thing that Yugoslavia succeeded, which is worker, a certain experiment in worker self-management at the level of the firms. But what Yugoslavia's democratization brought with it, especially in the 70s, is market liberalization, which most people agree had a very negative impact for the country, meaning that it fell apart in 20 years' time, in part because of this. What were Dubček's policies on market liberalization, and perhaps could you assess what kind of impact they would have?
I mean, the last question, very difficult. It's very difficult to answer. And for example, from the Slovak side, there were the concerns about autonomy, was about autonomy in economic policy decision making as well. And I would say possibly the Slovak side was a bit more hesitating in regard to that market liberalization, because Slovakia was a weaker part, economically weaker part of the federation. And the question would be whether there could be democratization of economic policy making, which might maybe increase a bit the role of so-called market, but without going so far as Yugoslavia went in the 1970s. And I would say that Dubček himself was not very strongly involved in the economic questions. And it was, regard to these economic questions, interestingly enough, it was almost exclusively Czech economists who were the key proponents of the reforms. They were discussed in Slovakia as well, but I would say not as prominently as in the Czech lands, and maybe that is not a coincidence. And it was rather people like Ota Šík or Jiří Kosta, rather than Dubček himself, who debated these economic questions. I would say that Dubček himself rather had the role of a moderator of these debates. The Czechoslovak leadership, differently from Yugoslavia, did not openly challenge the Soviet Union, and it it seems that many of them underestimated or malestimated the position of the Soviet leadership. In the beginning, the Soviet leadership was not opposed to the election of Dubček. Dubček even had grown up in the Soviet Union. The father of Alexander Dubček emigrated in the early 1920s to the Soviet Union for political reasons. Communist solidarity. Dubček grew up in his youth in the Soviet Union, but his father, returned in the late 1930s to Czechoslovakia, already when it was clear that the war would begin. So obviously the father had certain apprehensions about the Stalinist developments in the Soviet Union, and he knew that he would return to a very difficult situation in Slovakia. The father of Alexander Dubček was active in the resistance movement, was severely tortured because of that. And Alexander Dubček, as far as I know, he spoke better Russian than Slovak, and particularly better than Czech. And Soviet leadership at that time, Brezhnev already, I would say that was a form of a mild restoration in regard to the late 1950s and early 1960s, that is the Khrushchev era. And it seems that in their ideas, I would say it's something like a certain bureaucratic leading role of the party was the essence of state socialism, and that did not really fit with what was going on in Czechoslovakia. That is the democratization, and though I would say the majority of the KSČ still saw the party as a leading role in society, but they saw that, I mean, leading is a social process and not a bureaucratic procedure. Yeah? And that was a fundamental, difference. And I would say in the end, it was this point that was totally inacceptable to the Soviet leadership. And therefore it reacted as it did react, though the reaction, the position inside the Soviet leadership was not uniform either. Yeah. It was not openly discussed, but obviously it was not unanimous. And that, in a way the conditions for socialism in Czechoslovakia, or in furthering it in a democratic direction, were possibly in so far better as Czechoslovakia had a much longer democratic tradition, including the party. I mean, the party had in bourgeois times legal existence, but never had been the case in Russia. So far, different political culture could evolve. And insofar, I would say it was particularly tragic that this experience was destroyed. Yeah? And this destruction made, for example, the opposition in Poland rethink its own position vis-à-vis the party as well, giving up the hope for reform within the parameters of the party, for example. So far, it was not only a Czechoslovak event, but it had repercussions far beyond that.
Potem se pa za prisotnost mogoče razpolago še na
Dobro, sicer naslednji teden v istem terminu tukaj je predavala Martina Malešič, umetnostna zgodovinarka, tudi raziskovalka na umetnostni zgodovini in filozofski fakulteti v Ljubljani in sicer v slovenski stanovanjski gradnji v času socializma. Druga zadeva pa je že običajen bralni seminar, trenutno poteka zgolj v ponedeljku po 5. uri na sindikatih, Sovjetska zveza in njeni kritiki, da več se lahko tudi obrnite na tovariš Twitterjem pa Forlana. To je bilo pa tudi vse. Thank you very much once again, Joachim.
Hvala lepo.